Hey, this is Matt once again. Welcome back to another video. It's another paid request. This time for Mr. Block World. Thank you so much for that. For those interested in requesting any type of videos, topics, reactions, commentaries, reviews, re-reviews, what have you, feel free to send it either directly to my PayPal or join my Patreon. Both links are down below in the info box. Now, this is for a film called Hero from 1992, directed by Stephen Frears, who had done the John Cusack film High Fidelity, which that had John Cusack in it. The thing I remember the most about that film is Jack Black talking about Evil Dead 2 in that movie. And he also directed Mary Riley, which I was not a fan of. Now, this one is better than Mary Riley, but I wasn't a big fan of this either, sadly. Which is a shame because of the cast involved. You have Dustin Hoffman, who I do enjoy as an actor. Gina Davis, I'm a fan of hers. The Fly remake, Long Kiss Goodnight. Andy Garcia works well in certain movies. Black Rain, as Michael Douglas' partner. The Untouchables. You also have Joan Cusack. You got Tom Arnold. You got Chevy Chase. And a few others. And Dustin Hoffman plays this guy who is a pickpocket. And he's pretty much getting ready to get to prison. About 6 or so days. His ex-wife is played by Joan Cusack. His son is one of the kids from Hook. He was one of the Lost Boys. I forget what the character's name was, but I never recognized him. I'm like, that's one of the Lost Boys. Tom Arnold is a friend of Dustin Hoffman's. He runs a bar. He appears a couple times. He doesn't really have anything important with the plot, but just once in a while appears. And he's a character that really only cares about himself, Dustin Hoffman's character, and that's why his wife is an ex-wife, that's why he's going to prison, and he'll like to do these scams with credit cards and things of that nature. A little bit like his character in, what was it, Midnight Cowboy? The Rizzo, a little bit of that type of character. Some critics say he's like Rain Man. I have no idea what they're talking about. I see nothing of Rain Man in this. Gina Davis is a reporter, which the first scene she's interviewing Edward Herdman, who I recognize. He was in the original Lost Boys movie. He was in the Lost Boys movie. I say original because there was two sequels after that, but he was in the first one. Been a few other movies and shows, and like she's interviewing him, and then he jumps off the building. But I didn't expect that. Granted, the way they react to it, like Gina Davis does say, "Well, you know, I should have felt something more." I guess maybe you say that's her arc in the film, but I don't know. Made her come off as a bit cold and unlikable. That's the thing, is that there's not a whole lot of people that come off likable in this movie. And I get that the movie, well, before I go on, the gist of the movie is Gina Davis got this award for being a good reporter, going home on a plane, her plane crashes. The plane crashes right in front of Dustin Hoffman's character. He hears people screaming for help. He decides to go. Granted, he takes his time. Hold on, hold on, these are $100 shoes. Takes them off, goes in, does help out. He's complaining the whole time. He's cussing, but he does help. He helps get them out. A boy asks, hey, can you help get my father? He's like, ah, damn it. Goes back in, helping people, including Gina Davis. He loses one of his shoes. He gets out of there. He's all muddied up. He walks away. He goes to his ex-wife because he was supposed to see his kid. You think there's a lot of ways to explain what happened? He was in a car crash? Because he has no car. Yeah, he didn't really have much of a car because they had to move it. But it seemed like there were ways he could explain Like, look at my car. Can't you see? I was in a car crash. But, Joan Tiazza doesn't want to hear it, I guess. So he's depressed. He feels bad that he did, he's getting ready for prison. His ex-wife hates him even more. His kids disappointed in him. And he needs a ride, so he gets a ride from this homeless guy who lives in his car, played by Andy Garcia. Does the lawman gives him his other shoe. Fine, take it. I won't need it anyway. Meanwhile, Gina Davis and her boss, played by Chevy Chase, they set up this reward of who was the savior of this plane. There's going to be a reward. Hey, we found this one shoe at the plane. If someone has the other shoe. So just like a little bit of Cinderella thing there. If the shoe fits. Right as when Dasam is ready to go to jail, he sees that there's a reward. But then he's in jail, so he can't get it. And instead, someone else takes the credit. As Andy Garcia's character, he takes the credit, and he's this saintly figure that says all the right things. And when he's cleaned up, he's handsome, he's good looking. Gina Davis is falling for him. He says all the right things, and when he gets the money, he gives it and helps the homeless, and it makes everybody's much more positive. And oh my God, what a hero! What a guy! And makes everyone nicer. Even Dustin Hoffman gets bailed out for a bit. By his lawyer helped. And the rest of the film is pretty much Dustin Hoffman like trying to get to Garcia about, hey, that's my money. I'm the guy who did it. And it's trying to be take a 1930s movie but make it in a modern setting. I don't think that works because I don't. Those two worlds, that's a hard thing to combine because they're so different. Like that 1930s trying to be sensibility, it just. But then you're trying to have this cynicism of the 90s. It's just not a great melding of those two worlds. And for a film that's a. About 2 hours long. It's not as funny as it could be because I think they should have just stuck with. Take this idea, that's an interesting idea. What if you save these people, but then someone took the credit, but no one would believe you because you're a crook, and this guy's so saintly and seems like such a great guy, why would anyone believe you? But they don't really go much with that because there's not a whole lot of Dustin Hoffman trying to tell people he's the guy. They didn't really go that route. Where he these consistent amount of misadventures where he's trying to get people, no, it's me, and I did this and I did that, and they keep not believing him and they keep saying bad things about him, and then maybe some people doubt it. That's not really the case. In fact, it seems like it takes forever for the plot to finally kick into gear. And by the time it does, we're like, some stuff happens and we're almost to the elongated third act of the story. Gina Davis, I do like I said, as an actress. I don't know if her terror. Like I said, it's hard to really root for anybody. Dustin Hoffman. At least they're purposely making him, okay, he's a jerk. But at the same time, as even Joan Cusack has to tell the audience that when there's a emergency, he'll actually seem like a human being. And while I like Dustin Hoffman as an actor, I think he was miscast in the role. I think you needed someone like a Joe Pesci or Bill Murray there to really get that. Well, he seems like a nasty piece of work, but he's really got that wit, that smart ass quality to really throw those barbs out there that get the chuckles and laughs out of the audience. Now, granted, at this time, Joe Pesci, I mean, he was doing My Cousin Vinny, Home Alone 2. Let's see. This around the time you have films like The Super, that film The Public Eye, all this other stuff. Bill Murray. A year later, Groundhog Day. In a way, is him doing that role well. Like the way Bill Murray plays Groundhog Day, where he's a jerk, but then throughout this arc, he becomes a better human being. His true colors come to fruition. And it's a much more successful, better movie, and funnier movie. I also, th so, like, again, but if you had someone like a Joe Pesci and a Bill Murray, I think that really could have hit his stride more with the humor for the lead character. I think trying to be in 1930s was a bit of a mistake. As close to being successful as that is probably Chevy Chase's character. Because he did. In fact, Chevy Chase might have been better as the lead. Now that I think about it, he might have been better as the lead compared to. I mean, Dustin Hoffman is a better actor, but I think Chevy Chase is the better comedian. And I do think a comedian would have been the better choice for this lead character for this type of role. Just as a thing, it's like it's a drama, but I think more so it wants to be a comedy, and I just didn't think it was that funny. It also needed to be really tightened up. The pacing needed to be tightened up. And the movie just comes off as a bit uninteresting. Because it's like Gina Davis, her character is really not that likable. It just, she wants the story. And like I said, with her reaction to the guy jumping off the building at the beginning. Seems a bit too cold. Her cameraman, I got so annoyed with, is played by Kevin J. O'Connor, who I do like as an actor. He was in Clive Barker's Lord of Illusions. He was in Deep Rising. He was in The Mummy with Brendan Fraser. Here, he's a cameraman. Each time he has a shot, he always has to talk in third person. And it's like explaining verbatim what he's doing in this pretentious way. Oh my God, I got the shot. And the speckles of time is showcasing out. It's like, oh my, shut up, dude. God, I was so annoyed by his third person narration pretentiousness about getting the shot. Just shut up. Andy Garcia, sorry, that's why I blanked out because I wonder who I talked about next. Andy Garcia, just idea that he's supposed to be such a saintly character, but he just comes off as a bit bland. And I don't know if Andy Garcia was the right role for this. I mean, it seems like you should have had someone like a Brad Pitt type of character. George Clooney, like that type of. I mean, I don't know what George Clooney was doing in 1992, but like that type of person I think would have worked better for that role. Or maybe have a little bit of dirt on the armor of Andy Garcia's character, because again, he just comes off as so saintly, so wonderful that he just. He had a bit of a boring character. And this what I mean is that as the story goes along, I get this trying to get the invocation of how the media will take something and even though it's wrong, they'll use it to their own fruition. But at the same time, when someone literally is presenting their case, like, yes, I am. I had the evidence. I am that guy. You can't really blame the media for thinking that way because what else would they think? I was trying to say how the media, like they'll take something, and even though they're saying that it's true, we know that it's not true, and how the media could be wrong in certain things. But at the same time, you look at the way it's presented, I can't really blame the media for doing what it did in the movie. If it's trying to be a, not an attack, but it's supposed to be a argument about the media, what did the media itself really do wrong? They reported an incident. This guy came up and lied, which makes him kind of shitty as well. Instead of like finding the actual guy, let me give you your shoe back, or anything else, you took his spot and you took his money. I mean, So I guess that's the one speck of armor he has. But it's like this guy comes in, I got the evidence, I got the other shoe, he's so nice, he's giving stuff to homeless people. I mean, like, with what he's doing, what else would you think of it? What else do you expect? But I guess, is a hero noteworthy even though he's a false hero? Well, maybe some meat to the matter could have been done with that plot, but to me, it didn't really delve that deep into it, as much as the movie maybe thinks it did. Other than maybe a few moments, like when Dustin Hoffman's talking with Tom Arnold, and Tom Arnold's so enraptured with the Andy Garcia's character on TV, and Dustin Hoffman asks, "If I said that, would you believe me?" I mean, not for nothing, it's just not your character. I mean, it's not my character either. We're just not those kind of guys. That showed you how Andy Garcia inspires folks. There's a docudrama done with the actual people. And going back to Dustin Hoffman, like I said, there are moments where there's a line of dialogue that I don't mind. Like when he enters the plan to save people and he's like, "Yo, speak up, man. Don't be an asshole." Or, "Give me a hand, lady. I'm not a goddamn bodybuilder." Or later on, when Andy Garcia gets on this ledge because I guess he feels guilty or whatever else is going on. That almost feels like it comes out of nowhere when this happens. Because he's be enjoying it perfectly fine, and you got the Geena Davis stuff, and he's. His goal is to use his money to help the homeless, and it seems like he would continue to do that. So him then all of a sudden changing his mind to now want to jump off this ledge, it just seemed, like I said, there are a couple months he seems a bit nervous about it, but I don't know. The leap, so to speak, to go on the ledge just felt a bit too big of a leap for me for that character. But I do like when Dustin Hoffman goes up to him and he's like, has this plan of, "Listen, you don't tell anybody, I won't tell anybody. Listen, they want you as the hero. I'm not that kind of guy. I'm not the image for it. You're the perfect image for it. You go along with it. You sure you don't want to take credit?" "Nah, I don't take credit. I'm a cash kind of guy." I like that line. But Dustin Hoffman, it just doesn't flow out of his mouth as well as if it was, again, a Bill Murray. Like Joe Pesci. I keep thinking like Joe Pesci would have been a great choice for this. But again, he was doing My Cousin Vinny and all that other stuff. But like that type of would have been a bit of a better guy. Maybe even like an Al Pacino, maybe. But I don't know, maybe you would run into the same problems. I don't know. I think what really, like, okay. Like, I don't think this is an awful film. It's not a god-awful, terrible film. At times it was watchable because I do like some of the actors. I think the few and far between scenes Chevy Chase is in it, he kind of, with the whole 1930s feel is going for, even though it takes place in, at this point, modern times, he kind of was fit for that joke with the way he played that character, Gina Davis' boss. Like, he fit the tone well, while the others didn't quite, they missed a bit of the mark. But, like, the scene where the finale that goes on for way too long, where they're on this ledge and they're talking, and then Dustin Hoffman's kid sees it on the TV, "Mom, it's Dad!" And then Joan Cusack says it, "Oh my God, it's really him." Then Tom Arnold sees it on the TV, then Gina Davis sees Dustin Hoffman, and then he's got mud on his face and realizes, wait a minute, that looks like the guy that really saved me. And then they're talking more, and then let's get off this ledge. But then he slips. The firemen are literally, like, the people really telling him, oh, just leave him, he'll take you both down. And then Andy Garcia saves Dustin Hoffman. That scene where then it goes to the crowd and it has this over-the-top music of duh, 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 glory, glory, hallelujah. It's like going across the people faces, and then it melds with the other people's faces. Not melds, but it's like dissolve. And like all these angles of all these people kind of staring at it. I guess some of the like 1930 for like movie would try to do to be so patriotic and so it comes off as really corny. It comes off as really camp, like cornball. And I kind of wish that this idea of the actual hero not being the image of a hero, and the image of a hero, but he wasn't really the hero. And maybe that butting of heads. I think if delved into the cynical nature of the 90s at the time, I have a bit more biting satire and wit and a tighter pace, shave off like 20 minutes. Which I agree with Roger Ebert, he reviewed this film. I agree with the sentiment on that. And I didn't get a comedic actor that could really hit those barbs and that character out of the park. I think that could have helped measures a lot. Because the film did not do much when it came out. It did not do well. And like you look at the plot, you think there's gonna be a lot of scenes of Dustin Hoffman trying to prove he is who he is. But it feels like it takes an hour to get to that point. Because we're building up Dustin Hoffman, then we're building up he's a pickpocket, and then we're building up the ex-wife Joan Cusack, then we're building up Gina Davis, and then we're building up the plane crash, then we build up him, the ex-wife getting pissed off, then we're building, Gina Davis wanting the story, and then the reward, and then maybe go to jail, then oh yeah, I get out of jail. I didn't, by this point we're like an hour into the movie. And like if they're trying to do it with a romance between Gina Davis and Andy Garcia, I don't think that really works out. I just there's a dinner scene or two, but I don't know if I really feel the chemistry between those two characters. There's Garcia doing these nice things, and really it's just like two or three times he tries to talk to Andy Garcia, Dustin Hoffman's character, and then Gina Davis finding Dustin Hoffman and automatically thinking that he's trying to blackmail Andy Garcia. But I felt like this would be a bit more of him trying to prove people that he is the actual guy. Not a whole lot of that, though. I don't know, for some reason I thought that would be like a primal point in the movie. It's not. Instead, more time has to be this long ending on this ledge scene. So. So at the end of the day, like, it's not an awful, god-awful film, but I just thought it was just rather uninteresting. At least to me. So with that said, thanks for watching, take care, and we'll see you guys later. I do, well, one quick thing, I do like Chevy Chase's line of, you know, she's pretending to be a person, but she's really a reporter. Or when Andy Garcia gives his bid speech at the end, and everyone's being, oh, they tested Chevy Chase going, ah, oh, bullshit. Like, Chevy Chase seemed like he had the right tone for what this movie could have been. And if I want to see a comedy that's a 1930s type of comedy, but done in the 90s, I'll watch Oscar with Sylvester Stallone. But that actually takes place in that time period. And John Landis actually, I thought, fairly successfully had that slapdash comedic one thing after the other happening. And this just misplaced on this, and this just changed into this, and this terror comes in, and this madcap of comedic sensibility. I like Oscar. I think that's actually an underrated Stallone comedy. But that knew to take place in that old time, and I actually thought, a lot of people didn't like Stallone, but I thought Stallone was actually rather good in that movie, so. Oscar, I would say I prefer for that bit of business. Or like a Frank Capra type of sentiment. Maybe, in a weird way, maybe The Truman Show, where that I thought was a better take on the media, in this case, well, more so the TV audience, and the way TV producers manipulate a person's life, and how they're putting like these ads in there. That's a film that I thought worked better in terms of tone, humor, and right casting with Jim Carrey, The Truman Show. But at the same time, you have this kind of, you know, people loving Truman like people would love an old, you know, figure from back in the day, being sort of enraptured by his good-natured ideals. But either way, this I thought was a missed opportunity with this film. But with that said, thanks for watching, take care, and we'll see you guys later. Bye-bye.